Salut à tous, amigos y amigas, bienvenue au Baco Session. Que des bonnes vibes, que du bon son. Un invité, quelques questions ici à la cool, sans pression. Aujourd'hui, on invite monsieur Clinton Ferron, qui est un des grands pontes du reggae music, un des membres fondateurs d'un des plus grands groupes du mouvement dans les années 70 de Gladiators. Depuis la séparation dans les années 80 et un mouvement aux États-Unis, 13 albums solo au compteur, bientôt un 14e qui arrive, des classiques du genre, dont des pépites acoustiques, toujours dans une ligne directrice très roots, la même ligne directrice tout au long d'une carrière, très mélodique, toujours pas remarquée par cette voix rocailleuse qu'on lui connaît. On est aussi avec un producteur multi-instrumentiste, un humain positif avant tout, toujours le sourire aux lèvres. Mr. Ferron, it's a real pleasure to have you here. Thank you.
It's the very same, man.
Yeah,
very
thank
same.
You. How are you doing?
I'm doing okay.
You're doing good? Okay, that's
I'm
cool.
I'm doing totally fine.
That's nice. It's a real pleasure to have you here in this interview. We'll be talking about music. Well, obviously, it's a studio,
so
production also,
right.
Time and positivity, yep. Okay,
yep.
You agree? That's cool. I would like to start with a little story that I've heard. I heard you, it's a legend, I don't know, you build your own first guitar when you were young.
Yes,
That's true. Can you tell us a little more about this?
Well, when I was 9 years old, I saw it at the Scatterlights.
Yeah.
In Kingston at the stadium.
Mm-hmm.
What happened, you know, all the elementary school mm-hmm. met at the stadium for a big function.
Okay.
The Scatterlights were playing.
Okay.
And I saw them for the first time and I'm saying, uh-huh, that's exactly what I want to do when I grow up. You know what I mean?
Yeah, that's cool.
And so I came home, asked my dad to buy me a guitar. And he said, well, son, I don't have any money.
Mm.
You know? But I was, you know, anxiety, anxious, you know, really want a guitar.
Yeah, yeah.
So figuring out how I'm gonna get one. So right, you know, in a year's time, my friend and I, we took a piece of cedar trunk from the roadside that they put there to sell.
Yeah.
Took it to the house, you know, and I worked on it with my machete.
Yeah.
Because the idea was to make my own tools as well.
Yeah.
Okay, you know, I'm in the woods. Woods, you know.
You grew up in the woods.
Right. So, you know, sharpen my machete.
Sharpening everything.
Oh yeah, and shape the guitar, the neck, and the body out of one piece of wood. And then I get a 6-inch nail, you know, flatten the point of it, flatten it, and sharpen it. Like I use that for chisel.
Okay.
For chisel out, you know, and I have like a and the outside says like 4 inches, you know what I mean? Okay, measure, okay, 4 inches. And I do the sides, I did the sides right around, you know, say for 3.5 inch.
Yeah, yeah,
you know,
sure.
Okay, so, but then came the middle that, you know, more difficult. So what
but
I,
you were 9
so,
years
so
old
what,
at this
so what I did, at that time I was like 10. Because, you know, I contemplate what to do. How am I going to get a guitar? And, you know, and it wouldn't happen. So I decided to, you know, because I asked my dad more than once, you know, and he's still saying that him don't have any money. You know,
he
can't buy me one yet, you know. So, and I wanted one. So anyway, I get a piece of string, little tacks, and I talk. One here, one tuck here, one tuck here, one tuck here, one there, one here, one there, and then one here, you know, and tie strings.
Yeah.
And that was my template when I dig, you know, and I rest it against the string, you know, get a little piece of stick, you know, rest it against the string and make sure that, you know, I have 3.5, at least 3.5, you know, inches,
It was like all measured by the eye.
Yeah,
crazy.
Exactly.
Clinton Ferron, exactly. Really good eye. Okay. Don't doubt it.
Yeah. You know, but it's a long story. It's a long story. And then I asked a gentleman by name Mr. Cole to buy the strings and mm-hmm. the keys in Kingston for me.
Okay.
When I got it, you know, and put the strings on, I played at night until daylight.
Until daylight. It sounded good.
Oh, well. To me, it did.
It was
the best.
Yeah, for sure.
Right. Until then, I played on it for a while, and, you know, my dad used to go to Adventist church. So, you know, I went there with him, and I played it in church, too, you know, like, you know, okay. And then a friend of my dad, you know, had a real guitar. And my dad came home one evening and said, hey, I can't remember the guy's name, but, you know, like him said, hey, Mr. John, you know, has a guitar that he's selling, you know, do you want to go look at it? And I said, oh, yeah, but I don't have any money. Let's go look at it anyway, he said, you know. So we went, and it's a beautiful guitar. In comparison to mine, number one, you know what I mean?
With real luthier.
A real guitar, yeah. You know what I mean? So we went, you know, and then when we get back to the guy says selling the guitar for £13. Mm. You know, I don't have a penny, you know. So when we got back to the house, my dad said, hey, you know, see that piece of cane field down there, the one da 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 da, and he point out, you know, and yeah, if you weed that out, I'll give you the money to you know. So I went in the first day. Second day at about noon, he stopped me and said, okay, you know, I think you did enough, you know.
You deserve the guitar.
Yeah. Basically, they wanted me to work for it, you know. Yeah, they want to give me the guitar, but I have to do something, right. So
that's a nice lesson in life.
That nice lesson, you know. So, but him said that I only did £9 worth of work. Mm. So he gave me £9 and said, well, okay, here's an extra £2 on it. And then say, well, you know, now you can take that to Mr. John, but you know, and see if him will, and you got to find the other £2 to give him.
Yeah.
I still owe him £2. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? Because I never find £2.
You still owe him.
I still owe him.
Where are the rights, man? I don't know.
I still owe him the £2. And that guitar I took to Kingston with me.
Yeah.
You know, okay. When I was like 15.
Okay. Yeah, that's cool. Beautiful story to hear about dedication and love of music, you know?
I just love it. And I still love it. I still love it.
That's great to hear.
Yeah.
So we don't want no warm-up lads.
them. No gossip, no traitor shall be there. Oh no. They say your hands and your heart got to be clean to reach the other side of the mountain. Yeah, yeah, yeah. And say your hands and your heart got to be clean to reach the other side of the mountain. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Do 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 do.
Started your career in the 70s with the Gladiators.
Right.
At the time, where vocal trios were, you know, like kind of hype. You know, like looking at maybe a Motown's model. You know what was happening in America with the I don't know the Temptations or the Supremes.
Temptation, you know? was my one of my favorite groups.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Because I love harmony. I loved harmonies. Still love harmonies.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And singing that, groups. Right.
That's what I was asking for. Is where at this time, like, Jamaican studios looking at what was happening in the United States in the soul movement,
yes,
and did this influenced you in the, you know, because with the vocal trios like Mighty Diamonds or Abyssinians, you all have like that kind of you know, voices work that appeared to me on those records of Motown and stuff.
You're totally right. Well, what happened? Studio One was the first studio in Jamaica.
Mm-hmm.
Barry Gordy and Cox and Dodd, they were friends.
Okay.
And so Cox would go to America and bring back records to Jamaica, right? And then it decided to, you know, to get a studio because, you know, follow the same pattern.
Yeah, here,
you know, and then there was the Scatterlights, you know what I mean, and so have them guys and what they did, they like what you said, or I would say this, they play their own style on those, a lot of those rhythms that were like earlier Scatterlights, you know, they are all Motowns.
Mm.
most of them, it's all Motown, you know, and they would, you know, Guns That Never Rode, you know, several, you know, Dandruman, you know, back in the day, you know what I mean, a lot of those instrumental, Tom McCook and Roland and Fonso, all them guys, you know, many Motown songs that they do over instrumental wise and call it a name.
Yeah.
Well, Barry and Coxon is friends, so Barry didn't bother Coxon, you know what I mean? Yeah. Just let him go on, you know what I mean?
Okay. That's good. Yeah. And
even the dressing,
yeah.
You know what I mean? Because if you notice earlier on too, you know, like
Wailers, yeah,
Roy Shirley, all them cats, you know, totally suit and tie,
yeah,
you know what I mean?
All the same, you know, like a family.
Yeah, you know. Right.
That's
right.
Cool.
Later on, you know, break away from that.
Yeah, after that, but after that, there are other movements that, that maybe, you know, influenced Jamaica.
Yeah,
and so.
Yeah.
And, but you moved to America in the late 80s, right?
87 was my last tour with the Gladiators.
Okay.
And the tour ended in Florida, and we knew our brethren up in the Seattle area,
okay,
and called them up because we had a lot of time on our visa.
Mm-hmm.
So we checked him and said, "Hey, we have a lot of time on our visa. We'd love to do something before going back to Jamaica."
Yeah.
And he said, "Hey, if you can buy your ticket, come on up." So we bought our ticket. It's only Albert did not go.
Mm.
You know. And another brethren, I think it was Melvin Reed, he didn't go either. But the rest of us went to Seattle.
Yeah.
And we spent like 7 months there, you know, and did excellent, actually.
Yeah. And after that, you stayed there, and you had like your solo career starting in America.
Yes.
After all that time in America, do you feel more being like part of the American West Coast reggae school, you know, with guys like Groundations and stuff,
mm-hmm,
or you're more focused on the traditional Jamaican vibe, you know, to do your music?
It's more like, you know, anywhere I'm at, you know, I take little pieces from anywhere I'm at, from jazz, funk, blues, etc. You know, I take a little here and there, you know. But because the roots of, you know, rock steady to reggae, you know, that's my root.
Mm.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So I can't lose that.
Yeah.
Because that's me. You
that,
know?
That's your own line.
That's
right?
my roots there.
Yeah.
Okay. But I'll add other elements, you know, because when I started when we first started in Seattle, it was the Defenders.
Yeah.
Which is again members from the Gladiators.
Yeah, yeah.
Da, da, da. Then Defenders broke up. And then I had Boogie Brown.
Yeah.
Well, Boogie Brown, you know, is all musicians that, you know, went to music school doing jazz, da 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 da.
Yeah, it's another background.
But reggae is not their background.
Yeah.
But, you know, the ones I checked were totally enthusiastic and want to learn. So I'd be the patient one, you know, and say,
you'd be the professional.
And say, hey, so and so and so. And, you know what I mean? Show some points and give time for them to grow. You know what I mean? So that's what I did. You know, California reggae, I think, is a little bit different from even up where I am, you know, or from New York, for example. Because New York is more like, New York reggae is more so like, because there's a lot of Jamaicans there.
Yeah.
And in Florida and so forth, and Toronto, a lot of Jamaicans, you know. But you know, like I was saying, you know, I take a little from every little thing I hear.
Yeah,
you know,
and you bring it back to your music.
Yes, because that's how I learn.
That's cool.
Much as you want, but don't try to change us. trouble, trouble,
come trouble, trouble.
Mr. Big Man, help us if you can, but don't try to fix us. Don't play fish if you can't swim. Don't play with fire if you don't wanna get burned. Life is a gamble, so they say. But what shall we win? The end of the day. Hey. Experience is the greatest teacher of all. No need for defense. So much to gain, yeah. Whoa, 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 we got nothing to lose.
Wonderful multi-instrumentist, bassy, guitarist. You gave us the album Me and Me Guitar.
Right.
Why did you choose acoustic, to go acoustic? Is it a way to be like more natural and maybe more yourself, I don't know, in the songs, in the composition?
It's just for differences. And one main reason, there are others, but one main reason is like a lot of people know me as Basie. Yeah. They don't even know me as Clinton Ferron. They know me as Basie,
yeah,
from the Gladiators.
For sure.
Okay. And so when I started my thing, it's like, it's still Basie for a lot of people, you know. And not really, and also when I have Boogie Brown, mm-hmm. it was just Boogie Brown and not Clinton Ferron and Boogie Brown.
Yeah.
It's just Boogie Brown.
Yeah,
so
okay.
There's a lot of cats still that thought that Bogey Brown is a funk band based on the name.
It sounds like a New Orleans brass band, you know.
Right. so you know, some of my friends tell me and say, you know, even band members, you know, why don't you say Clinton Ferrand? You know, I didn't want to go in the front and, I'm in the front. You know, I wanted to keep it level with everyone. Yeah. So, you know, finally I did. Okay. But even when I did, you know what I mean, people still relate me to Gladiators and just Gladiators.
Yeah.
So I said, you know what? I don't think a lot of people still know my potential. Mm. So one way is to capture those songs that I did with the Gladiators, mm-hmm. do them acoustically, you know what I mean? And even the one before me and my guitar.
Yeah.
To say, well, hey, because I'm comfortable with the songs and the melodies, yeah. It makes me feel good, and I figure it will make others feel good too as well. Mm-hmm. You know, just the guitar and the song.
Yeah.
And I'm saying, well, no one is doing it. So, you know, no one is doing it, and it makes me feel good. And when someone come by, like friend come by and them see me doing it, them say, oh boy, Clinton, boy, that's bad. You know, So I'm saying, hey.
You should put it out.
It don't have to sell a million. Yeah. Once it get to the people it need to get to, I'm comfortable.
That's
you know what I mean? And with me and my guitar, it was that. And then I decided to do the one where we do over with the Gladiators thing, just to recapture that vibe.
Yeah, all those songs from that period.
Right, so people can know that this is me.
Yeah, and you
Clinton
also have a songwriting
not just
name. And yeah, right, for sure, I understand.
Right,
but it took some time for the people and you to go up front, on stage. Things took take time, you know?
You know, sometimes, you know what? When I was a kid, you know, and my dad was a farmer, so I tried to follow in his footstep a little bit. Mm. And I plan things, and in a couple of days, even the next day, I'm trying to see if it's growing yet.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Sometimes I kill the plant.
Yeah, because you want to be too fast.
I want a quick result, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
But you realize, you know, that you know. So farming is a way of teaching patience.
Do you have a little advice for us that we're starting a studio right now, which is brand new?
Oh, man, I tell you what, longevity. Longevity, you know, and patience, you know, and keep on working. If you love it, keep on doing it. In almost every concert I do, you know, I always tell my friends and fans, you know, find time to do what you love and love what you do, because it's the beginning of freedom, you know, in the true sense of the word.
You know, singing Why Worry? Aren't you worried about something?
Yeah.
Aren't you worried about anything?
No. I'm. You know, it's a reminder. It's a reminder, and I am also, in a way, you know, I'm reminding myself not to worry, because I'm kind of a worrier too. Mm. In the same breath, you know what I mean? If something's supposed to go and it's not going, why it's not going? You know, well, you know, I need to get, you know when I'm going to the airport, like we're going to fly to somewhere, we're there 2 hours before the time, just to make sure that we are on time.
Yeah.
And you don't have to stress about it. You understand what I mean? It's like, okay. But then when you look around you in life and things like that, you know, there's so many of us worrying, even if we seem like we are not, you know, we are worried. We are overamped.
Stressed by this, and then
so it's a reminder that don't forget to take care of ourselves. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Leave the stress for a minute.
Yeah.
Stop worry for a minute. Live a little.
That's been your main word during your whole career. Being positive.
You're totally right.
In the song Time, you also say that time is the master of all things. I think there is a time in life, you know, when you think you have time, and at some point you just like go on the other side and you realize that you don't. Have you already done what you wanted in your lifetime? Do you wish more time to accomplish more things?
I'm having it.
You're having it, you're taking it. That's cool. Nice answer, man.
That's my
answer, man.
Yeah, yeah, that's
on
my
zero. Clinton Ferron one, Chico zero. That's cool, man. So what should we use our time for?
Do the best we can, as long as we can. Yeah. Do the best we can. You know, there's a song I did much earlier on called The Best. I can't remember which album it's on, you know. And a part of the lyric is saying your best is the best. Mm. You know what I mean? Our best is the best. Your best
is the best.
Is the best.
Yeah.
My best is the best.
Yeah.
You understand what I mean? No one can do better than their best. You know, so we do our best and we leave the rest to the higher powers.
Do the best, leave the rest.
Oh boy, he's a poet, huh?
What's up, man? Songwriter, write me, okay? Take care of you.
Boom, boom.
Thank you very much, Clinton Ferron, for your time. Really glad that we could talk with you. So if you like, you can have a few last words for our viewers and listeners right here.
Our viewers and listeners, friends and fans, I say it all over again. Please do what you love and love what you do. Take care of yourself. No one will or can do it better than us. Bless.
Boom. Clinton Ferron say so. Merci beaucoup. Pew, pew.